Allah.
We waited for your arrival as you used to wait for my arrival.
Sorry.
Equal now. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم مشاهدينا الأعزاء نرحب بكم في لقاء آخر حيث نلتقي وأمير المؤمنين إمام الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية فنبدأ بطرح الأسئلة من الأخت معها تفضل.
These are still the questions from the sister.
Please
from
continue.
Syria.
Yes.
The question is, ما هي الشجرة التي منع آدم من الاقتراب منها? What is the tree which That's was right. forbidden for Adam?
Right. You know, this tree has been very intriguing, not only to the Muslims but also to the Jews and the Christians alike. All three religions are wandering and searching for the discovery of the nature of that tree. In Christianity, generally it is referred to as apple tree. But a Christian scholar has commented on this, also Jewish scholars, and they understand this term to apply to some spiritual message of sin or fault. And most often, unfortunately, they have inclined towards explaining it in the terms of man-woman relationship. And as such, Hawa is presented as tempting to Adam. And Adam fell for that trap. And then the eyes were opened, and this is, they feel, is the reason why their being naked is shown to them. As if they had for the first time realized that they were naked. And they tried to hide themselves with the leaves of the garden. All this is absolutely unacceptable by the Quranic expression, as we will demonstrate. Just a wild goose chase for a meaning which escapes them and they can't reach it anyway. And anything which is contradictory to the nature of prophethood and message of God cannot be acceptable at all anyway. And the Holy Quran has resolved this issue immediately by referring to Hawa as his zawj. You see? Adam and his zawj. So they were already, it seems, a married couple. So why should the married couple not know this? And why should their relationship become a sin at all? So Hawa and Adam, as presented by the Holy Quran, present also the key to the understanding of this. So it was nothing. It had nothing to do with their own personal sin of this nature, as they generally understand. Some Muslim scholars have also drifted in that direction. And some say it was wheat, the wheat crop, and the fruit of wheat, that is the seed of wheat, was forbidden them. And because they ate the seed of wheat, so they were made dependent on this forever, and this was a crime they had committed. Now, how stupid it seems, you know, unbelievable that God should create the seed of wheat for the purpose of sustenance of human race, and should declare it forbidden. What is wrong and with the seed of wheat? And while the Satan, according to the Bible, boasts of this tree being a tree which has been intentionally hidden by God, or kept from God, by God, for the humans to eat with the purpose of keeping them in darkness, with the purpose of shackling their intellects so they may not become wise, they may not begin to see things as God sees things, and so they may not become eternal. This is what Satan said, according to the Bible, but not according to the Quran. So there again there is a big difference. So for the identification of this tree, we have to look at it from various angles, as has been seen and observed in the history of Muslim scholars' search for this dilemma, the solution of this dilemma, and in the history of Christianity and Judaism, for their respective search for this dilemma. What the Quran has to say on this, I'll come to that later after this translation, please.
ردنا على سؤال الأخت. ذكر حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن هذه الشجرة, أي أن الشجرة التي ذكرت في التوراة وذكرت في القرآن أيضا, فإن الديانات الثلاث كانوا يحاولون ولا زالوا يحاولون معرفة هوية تلك الشجرة. فكما قال العلماء المسيحيين, كما وقد ذكر بعض العلماء المسيحيين واليهود, واتفقوا على أن هذه الشجرة هي ليست شجرة مادية كما ذكر في حسب اعتقادات علماء آخرين بأنها شجرة التفاح أو ما غير ذلك. ويقولون هذه شجرة التي تنسب إلى أخطاء الإنسان. ففي معظم هذه الأماكن فسرت هذه عني بهذه الشجرة حسب التفاسير بأنها الخطايا التي يرتكبها الإنسان, يرتكبها آدم وحواء, وأن حواء أدت إلى أغرت آدم وأوقعت فيه بالخطأ. وعندما بدأت لهم سوءتهما لأول مرة, بدأوا يقصفون من ورق الشجر ويغطون ويخفون عوراتهم. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين إن كل شيء يعارض القرآن الكريم لا يمكن قبوله, وهو مرفوض بشكل تام. ويقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين كيف, وقد فسر بعد هؤلاء العلماء أن هذه الخطيئة هي العلاقة بين الزوج, بين الذكر والأنثى. ويقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن في القرآن أعلن وذكر عن أن حواء كانت زوج آدم, فلا يمكن أن, فلماذا لا تكون هذه العلاقة معروفة ومتبعة لديهم, وكيف يمكن أن تكون هذه العلاقة وأن تؤدي في أن يقعوا في الخطأ. فلم يكن هنالك أي علاقة بهذا الخصوص. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن هنالك بعض المفسرين قالوا أن ذلك كان سنبلة القمح, وأن هذه السنابل أو هذا القمح أدى في ضلال سيدنا أو وقوع سيدنا آدم, وقوع آدم في الخطأ. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين لا يمكن, وهذا لا يمكن نسبه إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى بأن يخلق القمح كي يؤدي بالإنسان أو بالبشرية إلى في الوقوع في الخطأ. فكما ذكر في التوراة أن الشيطان قال لسيدنا لآدم أن هذه الشجرة أخفاها الله من البشرية أو من الناس كي يبقون في الضلال وأن لا يروا ما يراه الله سبحانه وتعالى. وهذا ما ذكر في التوراة, ولكن لم يذكر ذلك في القرآن الكريم. وقال حضرة أمير المؤمنين أنه سوف يذكر ذلك بعد قليل. وقال حضرته لمعرفة هوية تلك الشجرة يجب النظر من زوايا مختلفة وكثيرة حسب ما ظهر للعلماء المسلمين في خلال التاريخ, وكذلك لما ذكر فيما قبل بالنسبة لليهود والمسيحيين.
No, as far as that shajara is concerned, to call it an apple tree or a wheat tree or a sin related to man and woman relationship, that is totally unacceptable. And again, it is unbelievable that by the time Adam and Hawa were born, only around 6,000 years from now, 6,000 years behind us, the relationship between man and woman was unknown to any human beings. This is so stupid, unbelievable, completely rejected outright by the known history of human civilization. See, human civilized history extends back at least 25,000 years here in Europe, when they had learned to live like man and wife, and according to their own customs of the time, they lived in pairs and they knew how the children were born. And it extends generally 40,000 years in Australia, the history of civilization. And they knew how to live like husband and wife. So such a commentary on a divine book, which renders the nature of divine book as a book totally unworthy of trust, which gives lie to the united consensus, lesson of history we have drawn, a unanimous, I should say, not united, unanimous lesson of history that we have drawn from the study of human race all over the world. So these views are only of such ulema or mashayikh or Christian priests or Jewish elders who have a very limited view of the world around, read only the scriptures without knowing how God has created things, how God has created man. So this is unacceptable, absolutely rejectable. Again, according to Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the history of Adam extends much farther back. And according to some traditions which have been referred to by Ibn Arabi, the Adams had started coming 100,000 or more beyond, and Khana Kaaba has always been the center of their worship. And they have been circuiting around Khana Kaaba, so he saw once in a vision that Khana Kaaba was visited by certain people who seemed to be different, and they were singing a song while circuiting, that we are circuiting this ancient house of God like prior to us children of other Adams also used to do this. So he inquired, amazed, at what do you mean by children of other? He said, we are the children. He said, which Adam are you talking about? There's so many. During the past 100,000 or more years, so many Adams have appeared in the world. So which Adam are you talking about? Then, this is the general reference to, not a detailed, absolutely correct account, but the substance of this observation of Hazrat Ibn Arabi is correct. The central point of this is that when I heard this man singing and circuiting Kaaba, and when I inquired from him and he told me that our Adam was just, just one of so many, then I remembered a hadith, he writes, in which Ahadrus sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had reported that hundreds of thousands or maybe 100,000 Adams had appeared in the world at different times. So with this grand view of the human race having been born much, much earlier than the time of this Adam, as we know, we come to the exact scientific finding of man to tally with this. There is no contradiction between scientific research or social research into the man's past and behavior and civilization, evolution of civilization, etc. Read them together and there is no contradiction. So this has to be accepted as a fact, and anything contradictory to this fact should not be accepted. See, as yet I have not yet spoken of this shajara. I am only talking that I'm only pointing out that all interpretations which contradict the human historical experience and the scientific experience must be rejected. Adam and Eve, as the Holy Quran has said, must be accepted as husband and wife. They knew what their auras were. They knew what they should hide and what they should not. Man had reached an advanced civilization. Man had learned to live in the open, in houses built by man. It was no longer the age of the caves. It was no longer the age of the stones or other such ages like Iron Age and things. It was a very advanced age we're talking about. So any interpretation which is contradictory to this accepted unanimous verdict of man's research must be rejected. Correct? But we'll go bit by bit. Let him first translate, then inshallah we'll turn to the other part.
يقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين بالنسبة لهذه الشجرة كما يذكر هؤلاء العلماء كأنها كانت شجرة تفاح أو القمح أو أن كانت العلاقة بين الذكر والأنثى فلا يمكن قبولها ولا بأي شكل. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن العلاقة بين الذكر والأنثى عرفت أو يمكن وجود أثرها قبل 6000 وأن سيدنا آدم أن آدم جاء قبل 6000 سنة وأن هذه العلاقة كانت عندها معروفة لدى البشرية. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن التاريخ هنا في أوروبا يرجع إلى 25000 سنة ويعرف أن هذه العلاقة كانت معروفة ومتبعة لدى هذه الشعوب وكانوا يعيشون كزوج وزوجة ويعيشون الحياة الطبيعية التي نعرفها. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن في أستراليا قبل 40000 سنة هذه العلاقة وهذه العادة كان عرفت أيضا في 40000 سنة.
40000.
عرفت أيضا في أستراليا وأن هذه كانت متبعة لديهم وعاشوا كزوج زوج وزوجة بشكل عادي. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين نسب شيء ذلك الادعاء إلى كتاب سماوي أي كان يعد سخافة وحماقة كبيرة. فهذا ما اتخذه وفسره العلماء اليهود والمسيحيين الذين لم يكن لديهم إلمام بالعلم الدنيوي أو بالتاريخ الإنسانية. وحسب ما ذكره الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم أن كان هنالك العديد آلاف والآلاف من آدم على وجه هذه الأرض. فذكر أيضا بالنسبة لمحي الدين ابن عربي أن آدم جاء قبل مئات آلاف وآلاف السنين وأنه رأى في الكشف أن هنالك بعض الناس يطوفون في الكعبة وأن هذه الكعبة كانت في مكانها وأنه سمع صوت الطائفين يقولون أن
This is the ancient house of God which we have been circuiting for 100,000 years or so, you know, different people at different times. He was amazed, you know, at this.
وكانوا يقولون أنهم يطوفون حول هذا البيت الذي كان يطوف آباؤهم والناس من قبلهم وذكروا أيضا آدم وعندما سأل ابن عربي أحد الطائفين أي آدم تعنون فهنالك كان الكثير منهم على وجه هذه الأرض.
He told him. He thought his Adam was the only Adam. So he was perplexed, which Adam he is referring to. He said, I am the son of Adam, our Adam is only that much old, and you are talking of hundred thousand years. So they said, you don't know. Which Adam are you talking about? Our Adams are ancient, you know, there are so many. That is the dialogue which took place.
يقول حضرت أمير المؤمنين أن كان يسأل عن أن آدم كان فقط قبل سنين قليل ليست كثيرة فقال أي آدم تعني أنت فلقد كان الكثير منهم على وجه هذا الأرض وما يفوق 100,000 منهم في أوقات مختلفة أرسلوا إلى هذه الأرض فهذه العلاقة كما ذكر حضرت أمير المؤمنين أنها كانت معروفة لدى البشرية منذ آلاف
Then Ibn Arabi says that this reminded him of a hadith in which Ahadrat sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said exactly the same thing. Now, although he does not report the sanad, but Ibn Arabi is a man of, you know, high spiritual value. Had he not heard this hadith from reliable sources, he could not have quoted it. And because this hadith is also applicable to our scientific knowledge and tallies with it, so there is no reason whatsoever to reject it as a false hadith.
لقد صححني أمير المؤمنين نسيت أن أذكر عندما سأل ذلك عندما سأل أحد الطائفين فعندما قال له أن كان هنالك الكثير أن الآدم الذي يعنون عنه كان قبل آلاف وآلاف السنين فعندها تذكر ابن عربي الحديث الذي عن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم أنها كان هنالك مئات الآلاف من آدم على وجه هذه الأرض ويقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن ابن عربي لم يذكر السند لهذا الحديث ولكن كما يعرف الجميع من هو ابن عربي وأنه لا يمكن أن يقتبس أي حديث غير موثوق به
من نفسه
وأن يختلقه من نفسه فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن هذه العلاقة كانت معروفة لدى البشرية منذ آلاف وآلاف السنين فهذه حقيقة مدعومة من ناحية علمية وليس علمية فقط بل كما ذكر في كما روي في تاريخ البشرية وكما ذكره من حديث في حديث الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم فكل شيء يعارض هذه الحقيقة وإنها حقيقة موجودة ومعروفة لدى العلماء جميعا فكل شيء يعارض هذه الحقيقة لا يمكن نسبه إلى أي كتاب سماوي فكما ذكر وأعلن عن آدم وحواء على أنهم زوج وزوجة فلا يمكن أن تكون هذه العلاقة كخطيئة وأن الإنسان عند ذلك كان قد تعلم العيش في البيوت وأنه كان في عصر متقدم نسبيا فكل شيء يعارض هذه الحقيقة لا يمكن نسبه إلى أي كتاب سماوي وبالخصوص إلى القرآن الكريم.
Now I turn to the Quranic references, taking it up from the beginning to the end. Because this is very important, we must have a very clear view of what the Quran speaks of our ancestors, what they did and what they did not and all that. The whole episode began with the izn of God to angels to prostrate before Adam. The whole story begins from that point. But to which Adam? The Adam to which Allah requires angels to prostrate is the one who has not only been prepared completely and finally completed, but the one in whom Allah breathes Himself. فَإِذَا سَوَّيْتُهُ وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي فَقَهُ لَهُ سَاجِدِينَ سَوَّيْتُهُ is not enough. نَفْخِ رُوح is important. So we are talking of Sharia. We are talking of the first religion which appeared at the beginning of our civilization. The first religion upon which was to appear the ultimate fruit of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah. So we are talking of this line of trees, and the story begins with this command of Allah that I am going to create Adam, not the first man, but one of the men who will be chosen by me, and when I breathe into him, then you must all prostrate. Because breath of God means ilham. Breath of God means the wahi of Nabuwa. So this is what makes him ulul amr. Otherwise man cannot be ulul amr. Amre Rabbi is breathed into him from God, and then he becomes representative of God on earth, and as such vicegerent he appears on earth as the ruler of the whole mankind by the izn of God, by the command of God, not by himself. So this is what we are witnessing, what happened. Man was already advanced and civilized when Satan refused to follow Adam, considering him to be below him. Then all the trouble begins. And then Satan, talking back to God, says, first of all, he says, give me more respite, more time, and give me more time till the end of the world, that is, till the day of resurrection or doomsday. Give me respite till doomsday. And if you do that, God said, yes, I give you this respite. He said, what I'll do, I'll sit on the path of Adam and his progeny, and I'll misguide them. I will draw them away from the right path, and then you will see how many I take away from you. Is this the thing to which you wanted me to bow? You know, that's a taunt. You have chosen Adam, and within your sight, if you permit me, I can cheat them, I can deceive them, I can lead them away from the right path, and till the end of the time you will see most of your servants would have become my servants. So that was a boast, but a very logical boast indeed. He said, you say I bow to them, they are going to bow to me, and I'm going to prove to you. So God said, still I permit that, but those who are truly my servants, who belong to me, do whatever you may, you will not be able to lead them away. Only those who are defective, who have already failed in abiding my instruction, they are your lot, you can take away, I don't care for them. Hell will be the abode of you and all you who follow you. But abadi laysa laka alayhim sultan, as far as my servants are concerned. And this was a wonderful reply to Adam's boast. His logic seemed to be a superior logic, apparently, you know, because he said, you ask me to bow to them and they are going to prostrate to me. I'll drive them away. Shall I bow to people like these? God said, no. When I make my Khalifa, I make my Khalifa from my chosen servants. They will never bow to you. And this is the meaning of Adam, the creation of Adam from an Adam. This is Khalq-e Akhar. So God was speaking of Khalq-e Akhar. He didn't say bow to Adam, because Adam didn't mean much. He said, Adams are so many, but the ones who become mine, in whom I breathe, they are superior to you. There is no question of that. they will not prostrate before you. Even if they make mistake, they'll turn back to me. You can't take them away permanently from me. Now, after this, the order of living in Jannah and not going to the Shajar follows this. So, let us read from the Holy Quran. In this context, first the meaning of Shajar as it appears logically. Yes. First of all, قَالَ اخْرُجْ مِنْهَا مَزْعُومًا مَدْهُورًا لَمَنْ تَبِعَكَ مِنْهُمْ لَأَمْلَأَنَّ جَهَنَّمَ مِنْكُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. God said to him, get out hence, despised and banished. Just vanish from here. Whoever of them shall follow thee, I will surely fill hell with you all. Why hell? Can you find a reason why hell? Because Satan had said, you have made me a fire, and you have made Adam a wet clay. So if the wet clay chooses to follow fire, then let it go to fire. Again, there is no compulsion from God. When you worship fire, when you choose your master as the one made by fire, so fire has to be your lot, it's your own choice. God had not made you to be sent to fire. You have chosen the path yourself. So this is why the Holy Quran says, all right, then hell would be the abode of you and all those who have chosen to follow you. But as far as Adam is concerned, here, now listen. وَيَا آدَمُ اسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةِ. Already they are husband and wife. Where is the sin involved? As far as Adam is concerned, he said, O Adam, listen to me. You live, you and your wife, in this Jannah. فَكُلَا مِنْ هَيْثُ شَيْتُمَا. Eat from whatever you please. وَلَا تَقْرَبَ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةَ. Don't get near this shajara. فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And otherwise, if you do that, you will become transgressors. The shajara is the shajara of violating the law of God. Shariat has already been revealed to Adam. Otherwise, the breath does not mean anything. فَإِذَا نَفَقْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِ. The ruh of God is that amr. Because يَسَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. So it is amr and ruh or sharia, whatever you call it, which we are dealing with here in this situation. So that shajara must be a representation of violation of the religious law which was revealed to Adam. Right? If you are lax in that, if you fall into the trap of Satan and go near this shajara, then you like him, you will be defying my authority. And if you defy my authority, then you will be like him, min al-zalimeen. It's very logical and understandable. Now, how do we why should we translate shajara as an evil tree? An evil tree in the sense that you violate the laws of God, the word of God. This has already been explained in the Holy Quran in such clear terms that leave no doubt for us that this translation and interpretation is correct. Masul Kashajaratin. Now this is a masal. Remember this. There was no such tree as bearing fruits of this sort. أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضُرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَّجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرُّهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ.
توتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس لعلهم يتذكروا ومثل كلمة خبيثة كشجرة خبيثة. This is a شجرة خبيثة. You see? كمثل الشجرة كشجرة خبيثة نشتست من فوق الأرض ما لها من قرار. Those who do not follow the word of God, they have no roots left. They are carried away by winds, you know, from all sides, in whichever direction they blow. They carry such trees, uprooted foliage and trees, etc., here today, there tomorrow, and they have no direction, no footing. While about the Shajara Tayyiba is also Kalam, because it says, Kalimatan Tayyiba, is the word of God. It is deeply rooted, it is firm, and it cannot be carried away from here to there. The winds do not destroy it. And although deeply rooted on earth, it has its shoots, its branches, talking with the heavens, because they rise so high as their end, the top of such trees is in the heavens. And what happens to them? They draw their fruits from heaven, because it says, أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرُّهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ تُوْتِي أُكُلَهَا كُلَّ هِينٍ بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهَا. They are not dependent on either spring or afflicted by the fall. Changing seasons and times do not matter to them. They are constant, and they constantly receive fruit of their piety from the Lord. Because فَرُّهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ, they rise towards God. وَيَذِبُ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالَ لِلنَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. God quotes these examples and so that you, to remind you, to you think, you draw your lessons from these things. So according to this, the Shajarat Khabisa is that path which breaks and violates the law of God revealed to prophets. And every time a new Adam is born, when a Sharia is born, every time this trial begins anew, and new Satans and new Iblises are created to oppose the path of the Sharia. And this also gives you the true meaning of Jannah on earth. This Jannah was not rooted somewhere in the heaven, because both trees, the good tree and the bad trees, the Jannah and the evil tree, they were rooted firmly in earth. Not firmly, the Jannah was firmly rooted, the other was just uprooted tree. So any tree of Jannah which becomes uprooted and dies out, this becomes the non-tayyib, filthy tree, which is created out of violence, out of violation of God's laws. And if you do not violate the laws of God, then a Jannah on earth is created for man. The moment you begin to violate his laws, the same, you are turned out of the Jannah, means that instead of living in a Jannah, you begin to see that you are living in a hell. So man creates his own Jannah here on earth by following the teachings of Allah, and by defying the same teachings, he creates hell for himself. So he no longer lives in that Jannah. So it is the movement from one state of affairs to another state of affairs. Now, although Adam was forgiven by God, because when he committed a violation of God's instruction, whatever it was, he did not do it with conscious effort. He was mistaken. Satan had him slip. So the Holy Quran says, according to the Holy Quran, Allah tells us, وَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُ عَزْمًا. He slipped, but it was not a willful act of sin. So, Anbiya are masoom from this. So was Adam. Although he made a mistake, but not willfully. He was led to believe in something which was not true. And the moment he realized, then he started turning to God with prayers and addressing him as if he did not forgive him, then he would be from among the zalimeen. Nothing else could save him. Now, sa'atihima are this weakness. All the weaknesses or ills which are always created because of violation of God's law. Whenever you break a law of God, a concomitant evil is born. And constantly the heaven continues to turn into hell for mankind in relation to their violation of God's laws and at the speed at which they violate the laws of God. Now, this is not just a sermon, it is a hard fact I'm talking about. A reality which can be understood and demonstrated to you all easily. Now, look at any state in the world today, any political state, any country of the world today. The violation of God's commands, it is, which creates crimes. And it is the crimes which make the life hellish here on earth. And when the believers in a book or in a messenger follow the messenger to the eye, to the very last letter and spirit, a heaven is created where everybody is in peace and everybody is so happy, everybody is taking care of his brothers if they are at disadvantage. There is no widow left untaken care of. There is no orphan left without there's some mentor to take care of his requirements and needs. There is no needy left to die in hunger. There is no destitute to bite dust. For every such person, a provision is made. And the minimum of heaven, which is described in the Holy Quran, which was given to Adam, is exactly this. لَا تَزْمَعُ فِيهَا وَلَا تَضْحَى لَا تَجُوَ فِيهَا وَلَا تَعْرَى إِنَّ لَكَ. What is the Jannah? It is described there. إِنَّ لَكَ أَلَّا تَجُوَ فِيهَا وَلَا تَعْرَى وَأَنَّكَ لَا تَضْمَعُ فِيهَا وَلَا تَضْحَى. These are the four basic requirements of human survival. This was the Jannah which was granted to Adam. As long as he and his followers remained within the four walls of Allah's instruction, none was hungry, none was left without a shade, a cover over his head, without a roof over his head, none was without a dress, none was without water to drink from. This is the minimum requirements of human survival, which is guaranteed by religion when it comes, because religion creates sensibility to other people's requirements and needs. Religion prepares that ultimate consciousness of the surrounding. There is no longer one individual living for himself. It is religion which broadens the consciousness of life, and the suffering of another person somewhere else becomes the suffering of another person at a distant place, at a different place. So this is the meaning of unity of mu'mineen. When a jamaat of mu'mineen is created, according to Hadhrat sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if the toe suffers, the whole body feels the pain. When this happens, then nothing is left deprived of its due sources of survival. because the toes are situated at the very disadvantageous place. They take all the load and they serve, and there is nothing much in them to enjoy the consciousness of the head. Yet, even if a small toe is suffering, the head will never rest in peace. Some heads are sticking against the walls because there is pain in the little toe here. This is the Jannah which is created, and as such, the minimum equal requirements of the whole society are guaranteed. Now, when you begin to break the laws bit by bit, this Jannah crumbles off. And when Adam did such a mistake, although he was forgiven, he could not have been turned out of heaven or this Jannah himself. But wherever the followers of a prophet go, so must also the prophets go along with them. When the people of Moses sinned, and the Israelites were decreed to roam in the deserts for 40 years, did not Moses do the same with them? So it is not a question. Here Adam is not punished, nor Hawa, because the Holy Quran tells us they were already forgiven. But the society around them, they had in fact followed the violation of God's commands to a degree where it was no longer the Jannah. So instead of addressing the two, the Holy Quran speaks of the whole party, the whole people. Ehbitu minha jamia. Now, if Adam and Hawa were punished for their sin, what is this jamia? Satan is already turned out of Jannah. So this jamia shows that our interpretation is exactly right, is exactly according to the true import of the Quranic verses. It was the whole society of believers in Adam which were living in peace. When they started violating the laws of God, Adam of course was immediately realized and he was forgiven. But ordinary people went on. This is what happens every time. So this is the shajara khabisa which creates hell for a society which is created for Jannah. Translate this, and if we have time, we'll continue to follow the same subject more further, right? Otherwise, next time, inshallah.
قال حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن ما يذكره القرآن بالنسبة لآبائنا أو لتاريخ البشرية هو يبدأ من إذن الله سبحانه وتعالى للملائكة بالسجود إلى أو أمرهم بالسجود إلى سيدنا لسيدنا أمام سيدنا آدم عليه سيدنا آدم. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين إن ذلك الآدم لم يكن الآدم الغير متطور أو الغير ناضج، وإنما يقول حضرته أن ذلك الآدم لقد نفخ الله سبحانه وتعالى فيه، وأن النفخ يعني إرسال أو بعث الشريعة عن طريق ذلك الآدم، وإن الله إن الله سبحانه وتعالى أعلن أنه سوف ينفخ في ذلك الآدم، والنفخ يعني الوحي وكما ذكرنا الشريعة، وعندها يكون ممثلا لله سبحانه وتعالى ويظهر كقائد ويهدي بإذن الله سبحانه وتعالى. وعندها عندما رفض الشيطان السجود لآدم على أنه خلقه من نار وخلق آدم من طين، وأن آدم كان أقل درجة منه، وأن الشيطان طلب من الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يعطيه مهلة إلى يوم القيامة، وقال أنه سيعترض ويضل بني آدم، وعندها قال سوف تعرف كما أن جميعهم أو أغلبهم سيتبعونني ويتركون عبادتك، وأنهم عوضا عن أن من أن أسجد لهم هم سوف يسجدون لي. فهذا ما أراد أن يقوم به الشيطان، وهذا ما ذكر في القرآن الكريم. ولكن ردا قال الله سبحانه وتعالى أنك لن تمس ولن تصل إلى هؤلاء المتقين أو عبادي، حيث ذكر أن ليس لك أي سلطان على عبادي الذين يعبدونني، وأن الله سبحانه وتعالى جعل، وعندما يجعل الله سبحانه وتعالى خليفة له على هذه الأرض ويتبعه الناس، فلن يمكن للشيطان أن يصلهم ولا بأي شكل. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين عني هنا بالخلق الخلق الآخر، ولم يعنى بذلك الآدم الذي خلق في أول الخلق. وتطرق حضرة أمير المؤمنين إلى القرآن الكريم، وقال حضرته ذكر آية طويلة من سورة بالله الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، قل اخرج منها مذموم، قال اخرج منها مذؤوما مدحورا، لمن تبعك منهم لأملأن جهنم منكم أجمعين، ويا آدم اسكن أنت وزوجك الجنة فكلا من حيث شئتما ولا تقربا هذه الشجرة فتكونا من الظالمين. فوسوس لهما الشيطان ليبدي لهما ما وري عنهما من سوآتهما، وقال ما نهاكما ربكما عن هذه الشجرة إلا أن تكونا ملكين أو تكونا من الخالدين. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين لماذا ذكر هنا جهنم؟ لأن الشيطان خلق من النار، فإذا كانت مشيئة ذلك الإنسان أو ذلك الشخص أن يتخذ ذلك الشيطان أو يتخذ النار كمثالا له أن يتبعه، فسيكون مصيره النار. وقال ذكر في الآية ويا آدم اسكن أنت وزوجك الجنة، فلقد أعلن هنا على أن آدم وحواء زوجان في هذه الآية، فقال لهم الله سبحانه وتعالى أن لا يقربا هذه الشجرة فيكونا من الظالمين. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين الشجرة هي الشجرة التي تعني الخروج أو اقتحام شريعة أو الخروج عن قوانين الله سبحانه وتعالى. وكما ذكر فإن الشريعة كما ذكر حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن الشريعة أنزلت إلى آدم، وأن كما ذكر من النفخ حيث ذكر يسألونك عن الروح قل الروح من أمر ربي، وأن إذا الشيطان أضل آدم فسوف يكون مصيره كمصير ذلك الشيطان. فالتفسير بأن هذه الشجرة على أنها شجرة ملعونة ذكرت في أماكن عديدة في القرآن الكريم، وأن القرآن لم يدع لنا أي شك أو تخوف من هذا التفسير. وذكر حضرته آية ألم تر كيف ضرب الله مثلا كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء. فهذه تعني الشجرة أو الناس الذين يتبعون ذلك المرسل من الله سبحانه وتعالى، تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس لعلهم يتذكرون. ومثل كلمة خبيثة كشجرة خبيثة، فهنا ذكرت الشجرة الخبيثة والتي هي نفس الشجرة التي ذكرناها قبل قليل، اجتثت من فوق الأرض ما لها من قرار. فيقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين إن الشجرة الأولى شجرة فروعها في السماء، وأن أعلاها يصل إلى السماء، وأن هذه الشجرة لا تتعلق ولا بالمواسم والأحوال، وإنما هي شجرة ثابتة. وأن الشجرة الخبيثة هي الشجرة التي تدل عن وترمز إلى الخروج عن شريعة الله سبحانه وتعالى. فكل مرة يرسل الله سبحانه وتعالى شريعة, إذا أراد الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يرسل وينزل شريعة على هذه الأرض, فكان من الواجب أن يرسل آدم لهذه الأرض. وعندها يظهر شيطان الذي يحاول إضلال الناس عن اتباع هذه الشريعة. وهذا ما عني به أيضا بالجنة على هذه الأرض. فكل شجرة من الجنة تقتلع فإنها تصبح شجرة خبيثة, وهي نتيجة عن خروجها عن قانون وشريعة الله سبحانه وتعالى. وإذا اتبع الناس أو الإنسان القوانين والشريعة,
شيطان was the first شجرة خبيثة. It was a symbol of defiance of God, you know. Don't go near to such people who lead you away from God.
يقول حضرة أمير المؤمنين أن المثال الأول الذي أعطي أن كالشجرة الخبيثة هو الشيطان, حيث أمر الله سبحانه وتعالى أن لا نقرب تلك الشجرة كي لا تضل الناس. ويقول حضرته أن لو اتبعنا القوانين والشريعة فإن هذه الأرض ستظهر لنا كالجنة, وإذا خرجنا عن قوانين الله سبحانه وتعالى وشريعته فتكون وتظهر لنا هذه الأرض كجهنم. فبالنسبة لآدم غفر له عند ارتكاب خطائه الذي قام الشيطان بتضليله, ولكن عندما عرف ذلك بدأ يستغفر ربه ويدعوه وقال إن لم تغفر لنا فلنكونن من الخاسرين. وعندها عرفوا سوءاتهما, وعند كان ذلك عند خرق قوانين الله سبحانه وتعالى, فعرفوا أن كلما يخرقون قانونا من قوانين الله سبحانه
human
وتعالى.
Human weaknesses. سوءاتهما is the human weakness, inherent human weaknesses.
يقول حضرته أن سوءاتهما تعني هنا الضعف البشري أو الضعف الموجود في داخل
التقصير
الموجود في الإنسان, وأن كلما يقوم الإنسان بذلك فيشعر
بميلان إلى التقصير,
بأن بميلان إلى التقصير.
This is hidden in every body. So when you lean towards that melan, then we begin to follow shajara khabisa.
وذكر حضرته أن كلما خرقنا أحد هذه القوانين تظهر الميول إلى هذه الشجرة أكثر فأكثر. فيقول
Adam and Eve were shown by God, beware of mistakes in future. They are within you sometimes. And this is the meaning of shaitan, majra dam, running in the blood. So this is what they were warned against. If you don't do that, then you will turn out of Jannah. And the Jannah is also described. But he tells me that only 1 minute is left. So I think you better do it tomorrow. And before the time I arrive, you try to finish it in full, okay? So this is a very interesting story. What happened in the past and what God warned us against. This incident began at the time of Adam when the first Sharia was revealed. And then the story of sin begins from there. The sin is born always out of violation. And the violation is Shajara Khabisa, which we must not eat the fruit of. In short, this is the summing up. We'll turn to the rest tomorrow, inshallah, after the translation is completed, right?
Inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.